Right.
Hello. Hello. That was a big man with a beard. I'm not. I am a druid, I'm not a big man with a beard. It's my stunt beard. I've said this many times. You can't be a druid, you've not got a beard. Who's there? For those of you watching this on video, he's behind the camera, you don't get to see. Right. I'm a cat. I'm a cat, yeah. I'm not nervous. I don't have any at all. I'm a cat and I'm a druid. Honest. We're not talking about that though. It's more if you've got any labels or anything, that's my label that's nearest. But I won't hold it against anybody if they're anything else, because paganism is so all-encompassing. And I assume that everyone here knows roughly what paganism is, yes?
Yeah.
Does anyone not? Not sure? Shut up. Oh dear, we're gonna have fun here, aren't we? Ah, dear. Right. We're here to talk about something which I don't think gets talked about enough in paganism. Because as pagans, or as pagan affiliated, or pagan interested, or pagan curious, we realise that we have a connection with the natural world, yes? We see the sacred in the natural world, we're part of it, we're not overseeing it as such, we're not separate, we are animals in this cosmiverse. But a lot of people in modern paganism tend to come up to me very happily, I'm quite fine with it, just going, oh, love and light, great blessings. They are that perky. I'm not that perky. And it's fine, but what happens when it's not a time of love and light? And yes, we need light to survive, we need light to see, obviously, vitamin B and so forth. But is that right? Vitamin B from the sun? Vitamin
D.
There you go. I don't know. We need that. But the point at this time of the year is that we're entering the darker months, and this is still part of our pagan practice, and it's not something we can ignore. So what I'd like to talk about is not so much when the love and light is done, but when we enter the times of darkness, not dark and despair or anything like that, but darkness and inspiration, because this is deep inspiration. This isn't the stuff which is on show fully. This isn't the summer season and the summer solstice where everyone's out dancing around happy, because that has its place. But in the winter months, we have the time of hibernation. And as you probably know, if you start work on a Monday morning, hibernation is where you want to be. Yeah? I'm self-employed, it's most days. Oh, bedroom, duvet. But we are animals, and we feel that as the days are getting shorter and the nights are getting longer, we feel that in ourselves, yeah? We feel the tidal pull as things are changing, the moon is turning, the planet is turning. We are part of it all. As we've just passed the full moon, now we're entering the dark. Yeah, for those of you who feel that particularly. Some people go, oh, it's just women. So yes, my womb shouts at me every month regularly. But this isn't a woman thing. Men have it too, don't you guys? Every month wanting a big cake or something? But it is the thing, we all have these cycles, and they are completely natural. So now, it was actually interesting, after the school holidays had finished and everyone was going back, even the news had things over here of, oh, autumn's here, we're heading for the darkness. I'm thinking, hang on, what? Because we've got all the gorgeous colours on the trees. We're still in this stage. We are in this transitional time. And this, I say liminal, I suppose. It's the time between seasons, but autumn is gorgeous in itself. Obviously, we have Samhain at the end. But we are in the time of harvest right now. We are still harvesting what we did and what we felt and what we've accomplished in the summertime. So that light is now keeping us going through now. Yeah, which is, as I understand it from botanists and people like that, this is what makes the colour change of the leaves. So it is the light which fuels that colour change. But then you have, obviously, like this morning, the winds that blow the leaves down. You have the bare trees, You have the urge to hide under duvets. You have the urge to eat, let's say, wholesome foods.
Like when chocolate counts.
Yeah, chocolate. Chocolate is a fruit, it's fine. It's 45 a day, it's like coffee. What? I said it, I'm on camera, it's fine. But the point of the harvest is, as our ancestors knew, to keep us going over the winter. Because as we enter these winter months, we do have some things grow, but not by any means much. And the point of festivals after Samhain, particularly Yule, the Christmas festival, however you refer to it, is the midwinter festival of light, to keep us reminded of that light still, that the light potential is there. We have to burn fires, we have to cover our houses with immense amounts of Christmas light. I don't get that bit. But it's the thing, we have to remind ourselves of the light, because in the wilder world, it's gone, or there's less of it. We have the moon, which we all saw last night, I think, because it was lovely. We have that, but moonlight is very different to sunlight. And I do think sometimes when people come to you with the whole love and light idea, that if you do that too much light can burn you. You can be too exposed. You end up, it's an overload. We need the dark times. We need the moonlight. We need to sit in that quiet. And not with all of the fire festival stuff. That's nice and it keeps us going. But we need to sit in the dark. And I've written extensively, I have written about how I suffer from depression. So from my point of view, people say, oh, you've got seasonal affective disorder. I really don't know. I feel when the darker times come, I actually like it. I like the Samhain sort of season. I like this time right now because it's less harsh than the busy, frenetic summertime, which is always, for me, full of work, full of camps, full of stuff going on because this is what I do. And in winter, I've heard a lot of writers say it's writing time. It's knuckling down. It's doing what work needs to be done. But it's still, for me, harvesting the ideas which I had over the rest of the year. And now it's the quieter time where I have to basically go in and turn those into something. I have to make something. And again, it's the same as I say. I joke about the wholesome foods, but we turn the fruit which we harvest now into preserves which keep us going. Yeah, a lot of people have done that. There's a lot of people but making gin at the moment from the sloes and all of that. It's fine, it keeps us going. This is what we should do. But if you look at our ancestors, during the dark times, people came together like we are today. People came into their communities. They got together as families. You can spend time on your own, absolutely. But it's keeping each other going through these dark months. Yeah, because as someone who sometimes, when the depression hits, I want to shut the world out. It's not just hiding under the duvet and hibernating. It's shutting the door and going, no, I'm not talking to anybody. And it's very, very difficult because we still have to have that community. We have to have this tribe because this supports us. And if you let yourself listen, there will be people who understand. I'm sure, I'm seeing nodding heads here. There are people who understand. And even if you reach out a little bit on social media or something easy like that. Even a phone call can be too much, certainly meeting up can be too much. But just a little message on Facebook or Twitter or whatever, it's something and it lets you know other people are there. Because we have this tribe now, which is not necessarily meeting tangibly, but we can reach out. And I love the fact that I can now record this for people overseas, and I know that friends in Australia are gonna see this, and it's gonna be completely irrelevant. Because they're just entering spring. Hello, Kim. But it's the thing of the world still turns and the world still feels this pull one way or another. And we have to figure out where we are in it right now. And I've often said, and if you've read my books, you'll know and be bored, that my druidry condenses down into a single phrase, which is what does it for me and what reminds me. And it's, what are you doing? What are you doing? And I think that's how I've written it in the book. What are you doing? You are here. You are tangibly on this earth. Because gravity does that. We're always connected to the earth. Even if you fall over, it doesn't matter. If you're lying on the floor in pain or in bits or in laughter or whatever it is, you are still connected to the earth. Yeah? So what are you doing on it? What are you doing in this time? what do you feel that you need to do? And it's very different to what you should be doing. Because what we should be doing is usually something we might not want to. Yeah? Going to a job we don't like, or going to see people we're not sure of. It can be anything. Life is hard. But when we ask ourselves, what am I doing? Why are you doing what you are doing? And listen. Listen to the voice inside you that says, okay, I feel like completely censored. I'm staying in bed for a while, but then I'll get up and then I'll do something. And it's like, that's okay, because that's what I'm doing, and I will do my best, even when my best isn't much. If the squirrel is out there saying, right, I want to sleep, it's hibernation time, I need to go and get food and stash it, okay, let's do that and then go back to bed. The animals do this, and you see them doing it. Yeah? I don't want to go out in the rain, but I've got to go and get shopping. And same thing, really. But we have the ability to look after ourselves and do it in our own way. We, as pagans, I certainly say, have the gift of connecting with the world around and going, right, I'm flowing with this. It's a dark time. What do I need to do to nourish myself? And sometimes it is putting on lights. Sometimes it is like SAD lamps, which I actually have found to be very useful. Sometimes it is just lighting a candle. If you light a single candle and sit with it, that's tremendous magic, because that is still the wild fire, which is exactly the same fire as our ancestors sat with. Yeah? It's fire tamed into that one little wick. And when we have the bonfires at the festivals, they all start from that one flame. And if you look at the histories that we know, I'll say Celtic, I don't like that word really, but the tribes of these lands, these British Isles, if you look at the mythologies that we have, a lot of them mention cauldrons, and from the darkness of the cauldron came inspiration, came new life, came zombies, if you want to go that way. Zombie soldiers came out in one of them. Go read the ancient myths, they're great. Dave the Bard sings about them too. But from the darkness, from that cauldron, comes inspiration. From this cauldron, from this time of year, comes your inspiration and your dark and your spark, which is that flame. And this is something I try and visualise. And as I say, when my womb is shouting at me, it's easy. But when it's not, it's the thing of imagining a cauldron here, or imagining a flame in your heart. This is not gender specific, this can be anybody. Imagine something, I don't know, in the Tom and Jerry cartoons, I often said you've got a light bulb above the head, you know, ting. That spark of inspiration, that eureka moment. Whatever it is that makes that spark in you, and I've got the mental picture now of striking, you know, just striking flame to make flame. You are doing that, and you are keeping that flame going through the dark. You're sitting in it, you're sitting in this time of year, because we can't stop this. I heard stories of people in America when the eclipse happened saying, oh, can we not have it another day? I'm busy. No, because the universe is big. It's like, oh, it's snowing, oh, it stopped me going out. Okay, then stay in. Follow the squirrel's example and stock up and stay in and do what you've got to do. Because that's all you can do sometimes. Sometimes if you're feeling ill, if you're not physically able or mentally able, if you're, let's say, fully well, yeah, but you feel you should be doing something, it's like, oh, I feel fine, let's go to work, oh, I can't. Okay, what do I do? You do what you need to do from home. Yeah, you work with what you have. I'm getting a look now for my husband. I do give these talks, and every time I do, I have to listen to them myself, because this is something that I have to keep reminding myself of too. I am by no means perfect in this. I don't wake up every day and think, oh, wonderful, sit at my altar and do things. No, I have bad times. I have very, very bad times. But it is still the thing of, right, what can I do? What's the best I can do? And sometimes it's making a cup of tea. It's just something, I've said this often, the cup of tea ritual, you know, sorting the kettle, sorting the cup, sorting the tea leaves, teapot if you want. You know, however you do it, make something, because then you've got a cup of something warm and you've got to wait for it to cool and then you drink it and it's good and it sustains you. It keeps you going. Yeah? whatever it is that keeps you going, do it, because only you know that. And no one can say to you, oh, you should be doing this, you should be doing that. Really, what do you know about it? It's fine to listen to them and say, right, why? And I love saying why and challenging. Oh, when you feel really low, go for exercise. Are you going to come and put my shoes on for me? Because I can't bend over right now. You know, it's lift me out of bed with a hoist. That isn't a weight joke, that's just an I don't want to joke. And, you know, it's what can we do to look after ourselves to keep us going till spring? Because that is what we have to do. And this isn't just for people with any disability at all. This is for all of us, because we need to see the next spring. This is what our ancestors did. They came together, they sustained each other, and then they went back home and went, right, what are we doing? What can we, how do we keep fueled? How do we keep nourished? What ignites your spark? What does it for you? And some days for me, these modern days, I love that whole thing of blankets and Netflix, you know, or Netflix and tea, or there's always Netflix. Other service providers are available. I'm not sponsored. But whatever it is, I like the fact that Netflix is your modern bard, isn't it? It's the bard who travels into your home and tells you stories. Mm-hmm. Yeah? I'm sure Dave would agree. I bet it's just a matter of time before he gets on that. But it's the thing of, we have our modern stories. We have people saying, oh, I'm going to binge watch The Wire, or, you know, American Horror Story, or whatever. I don't know, but that's how we do it now. But sometimes it's best, sometimes we just want to sit with a book and go, yep, I will listen to another person tell me words to my brain. That's how books work, that's how they've worked for years. I have that private me time, because there is no one coming between you and that communion with the writer, which is why I love books. But then you can get together with people. Again, social media is wonderful, and say, oh, I've just seen this, I've just done this, we'll talk about it. Again, you're that excitement, you're keeping yourself buoyed up. And this time of year as well, you'll notice there is more festivals. There's this, obviously. But there's more markets. There's more things that happen to bring people together. And that's fine. But again, if you just want you in your place, or you and your immediate family and friends, whoever you call tribe, which might be by blood, it might not, it might just be by hand in hand, come together, be able to do that once in a while to keep yourself fueled, because your act of bringing people together fuels other people and keeps them going as well. Even if it is, I have a good friend who said, we must get together and have a girly night and watch Strictly. It's like, yeah, okay. Do I have to drive around there in pyjamas? You know, this is how it is in the world, and it's something that we do, and that's fine. Yeah, you giggle because it's silly. I'm like, yeah, it is, but it's fine. It's what we do. And one of my students said this week, and he's probably watching this when it goes out, that he hasn't been living a very druidy life lately. And I just want to say, well, what does that even mean? What does that mean? Are you going out and hugging trees every day? Because I don't know. I don't. Sorry. I go out and walk the dogs every day. That is me going out. And I do notice the trees changing and the fields changing. But I also pick up dog poo and deal with them trying to get to the lady dogs and all this sort of natural stuff. And I come home and have to do housework and jobs and writing and deadlines and things, because that's work. But you feel that spirit in the work you do. Yeah, no matter what you do, if you're making the wonderful wholesome food, that will nourish you and your family. If you're making tea, same again. Sometimes someone brought me tea earlier, it's wonderful, it's a gift. I'm not joking, it's so simple. Even just standing and watching the moon last night, that's a profoundly spiritual thing. And just taking time out to sit, as I say, with a candle, that's something. You can do that in the bath. Not in the bath, but well, you could, I suppose, it's bobbing candles, isn't it? But I wouldn't trust myself, I read in the bath, I'd set fire to things. But it's the thing, you can, whatever space you make it and you set it, and that is your ritual space. When I do things like, I hate hoovering because I've got very weak shoulders and the hoover is heavy. When I do that, I try and put on loud music and just end up sort of dancing around with Henry the Hoover. You know, it's making something out of something unpleasant. And if we whinge and we look at all of the news and things saying, oh, the world is in a terrible state, yeah, it absolutely is. The world needs help. But by being miserable is not good, it's not going to help. We acknowledge the bad stuff, but we go, right, how can we transform this? How can we change this? What can we do in ourselves that then reaches out? Yeah? And I find on my social media, there's a lot of, oh God, the world is ending, Trump has done this, blah, blah, blah. not getting into that. Those people who put up things saying, I've done this. I have a friend who's recently, she's become head of a local council, I believe. It's like, no, I can make a difference, I can make a change. And you see people, I've got a new book published, says someone else yesterday. It's, what are you doing? What are people doing that you think, yeah, I want to support that. I want to endorse that. I want to do something to make the world better in my small way. Because you can do that. And sometimes for me, it is just writing a book, which is the ultimate in lone activity. You're just sort of sitting there at your laptop like this until a dog pops up saying, I want to play. But you can feel very much that you're just navel-gazing, but you're not. Even if you're writing a blog post or whatever you wish to get it out there sooner, books take time, obviously, you are still communicating with your people, with your tribe. You're telling a story. You're being your bardic self. Even though it just feels like you on a laptop or in a notebook or whatever it is. Because this is constantly going. And even when it's not telling you useful things, even when you are in this hibernation time, that is still going and you can still seek the inspiration. That's the heart of what Druidry is. That's how I pin that to me. But it's something that we as pagans have. We have that connection, we have that awareness of our connection to the world, the seasons, the cycles, and we can do this. So, I would like you to ask yourselves what you're doing to bring in this harvest. What are you harvesting? What are you bringing home? What have you done this year that you want to celebrate? Because we should. We need celebration time. Yeah, doing that, going, yeah. And it's the thing, yes, everyone has done something. Because people say to me, oh, I'm not creative. Like, yeah, everyone is creative. I deny that anyone is no creative bone. Yes, you do. Whatever you do that you create and bring into the world is creative. Yeah? Not sure. If you write, if you paint, if you cook, if you clean, if you make babies, you know, whatever it is, you are bringing something into the world. No, you're not making babies. Well, you could. But if you've got young'uns, you can still play with them, and you're teaching them, and you're helping them. I'm a crazy auntie to several, and a lot of my nieces and nephews think it's great, because I don't tell them to eat their greens or do what they should. I say to them, right, okay, have you heard this myth? And I'll come up with something about the maypole. And they don't believe me. So it's a cock. No, it isn't. Because when you're an adult and you're telling youngsters something, they think you're having them on, but then they suddenly realise, hang on a minute, you're the mad auntie. You can be subversive, but you're making them think, because you're making them think outside the box. And you do this with other adults as well, of course. Even again, by social media, saying, how about this? How about that? Here's an idea. Here's an idea. Theresa May has a cold, and she's doing her best with a cold. Her best, I would say, probably isn't very good, but it's the best she can do that day, so there it is. You know? I'm not getting into politics. Because I'm not one to judge, and I like to hope that people are doing their best, even against all evidence. But all I can say is that I try and do my best, even when it is very difficult. And as I say, the love and light thing I find often overwhelming. And it's lovely, and I love the intention behind it. But I think, as pagans, we're still an evolving spirituality. All of our different ways and flavours and types and shades of paganism are subtly different. But they come together into a whole. We're not all going to think the same thing. So you have the lovely, love and light, unicorn, fluffy people, who are fabulous. I'm not one of them. But it's the thing of, okay, I'm an old goth, I can probably do my thing over here. And I say, right, well, I'm standing in the dark, and I know that very well. So I can tell people who are in the dark and having a difficult time. I can make a tea, I can light a fire, I can sit with people, whatever it is, just listen. I know this is a time for inspiration and recharging and resting and doing what we can. And I keep coming back to that, don't I? You do what you can, you do what you do, but be true to yourself. Be true to that spark that's in here, because you know the difference. You know when you're lying. Yeah, you know when you're fooling yourself and you think, oh, I'm doing this because I really want to. You know the difference, and it's up to you to be true to yourself. And go, yeah, I'm standing here in front of my ancestors, my gods, whoever the spirits are that I adhere to or follow or who keep watch over me. And I can't lie, can I? I can't lie in their face. And I often think that. I think, oh, I'm letting my ancestors down by being so useless. I'm not being useless, but my illness is telling me so. So it's up to me to pick myself up and to do what I can. So I'll ask you, how are we doing? We're okay. I'll ask you to think, as you go away from here, to think, what are you doing? What can you do? And be true. Make something. This season ahead, bear that in mind when you light a fire or strike a match or light the gas hob or turn the kettle on, whatever it is, you spark something in yourself and you keep yourself going. And by doing that, you keep others going. But be true. Ask yourself what it is. Seek it out. Seek your inspiration. And I'll see you here this time next year. 30:30 so we've got time for you to go and get to other talks and things, but I'm here. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Claire from the Isle of Wight. Oh. At this time of year when it's getting darker earlier and earlier every day, and it makes some people grumble, oh, it's already sunset.
Yes.
Do you recommend that we always do something each day at sunset, almost acknowledge that time has come?
Yeah, it can definitely help. I used to love it. When I used to commute, I would watch the sunset. It would be the same time on the clock every day as I travelled home in the train, but the sun would be in a slightly different place. And I love that. When I take the dogs out in the evening, you can see the sky change, you see the clouds, you see the colours. I love it because you're able to mark it. And I actually say it's much easier to celebrate solstices and the winter festivals, let's say, because in the summer you have to get up at 4 a.m, and in the winter you get up at 7, which is a bit easier. But it's that everybody can do this. Yeah, the sun will rise and set every day, so it's something we can do to mark it. And certainly, you look out. I try and look out the door and see the moon. It's magical, and we remember our place in the scheme of things. So. Any other thoughts? Okay, thank you very much. I have books downstairs on the Witchfest stall, and I've got cards here if anyone wants one. But look me up on Google, because my name is unusual enough that it comes up. And if you've any thoughts or questions, or you need someone over the coming months, drop me a message. Thank you. Bye.